So I'll be speaking today on arthroscopic arthrofibrosis for stiff knee. We are well aware that in our part of the world, the knee needs more mobility in terms of flexion for our social habits of sitting in the floor, sitting on the floor, and for spiritual reasons. Conventional treatment has been open quadricepsplasty. There are some problems which we are well aware which are there with open quadricepsplasty. The problems namely are skin breakdown. Any skin of the knee which has not been mobilized becomes inelastic, and when a long cut is made on that skin and after you start mobilizing, the skin tends to break down because it is inelastic. So this is one of the biggest problems. Second problem is that in open quadricepsplasty, in order to reach a fibrosis inside the joint, one has to cut through a healthy quadriceps mechanism. This adds to scarring of the procedure in open surgery, which can be one of the reasons for re-ankylosis. Another well-known problem with open quadricepsplasty is extensor lag. So all these problems which are there with open quadricepsplasty, arthroscopically we can obviate these problems. In arthroscopy, the scope goes directly inside the joint to the offending scar tissue. So surgical cutting can be confined just to the offending scar tissue, and there is no cut made to reach the scar tissue. So there is no fibrosis added after the surgery. It minimizes the disadvantages of open fibrosis. Very minimally traumatized in an arthroscopic procedure as opposed to an open quadricepsplasty. Arthroscopic arthrofibrosis in initial days, when I'm talking of 1990s, was mentioned as one of the contraindications. It was mentioned as a contraindication to arthroscopy. Now the same contraindication has become an indication. Why was it mentioned as a contraindication? If you look at the diagram on the right on the top, this is a diagrammatic representation of a fibrosis in the knee. So knee has got multiple fibrous septae inside the knee. These septae restrict the mobility of scope as well as instrument, because the scope as well as the instrument is all around surrounded by fibrosis. Another major problem is that we are used to triangulation, which means that if the scope is looking towards the instrument, it should be visible on its field of view. In a fibrosed knee, because of multiple fibrous septae, the joint is broken into multiple loculi. It's like small cavities which are separate and multiple. If the scope and the joint and the cutting instrument are not lying in the same cavity or loculus, then one, even with best triangulation, will not be able to visualize the instrument and start the procedure. This is the biggest difficulty which one faces. So in initial part, one has to do a little bit of patience and persistence and try to bring this cutting instrument in the same loculus or in the same field as where the tip of the arthroscope is lying. This requires patience and practice. Once this is brought into the same small loculus where the tip of the scope is lying, then surgical cutting under visualization can be done, and the scope of the joint keeps expanding. As this expands, the procedure becomes easier to move the instrument as well as the scope. One keeps on repeating the entire procedure through the entire parts of different parts of the joint, from suprapatellar to the gutters to infrapatellar area to intercondylar area to the joint area and to the lateral gutter area. So one can move the scope and under vision the cutting instruments to remove the cut and remove this fibrous tissue. So this is the technical difficulty which I have explained diagrammatically. When we are doing it, we will find it's useful if we keep this picture in mind. Arthrofibrolysis arthroscopically is a technique to cut and remove fibrosed motion restricting tissue from the joint. Scope can directly reach the scar tissue in joint without cutting through the healthy tissue. There is no large skin incision. These are the criteria for selection of cases for arthroscopic arthrofibrolysis. First criteria is there should be no gain in motion by conservative methods of physiotherapy, etc. The scarring pathology should be in or around the joint. The clinical feature is if the patellar mobility is restricted, then the ankylosis is inside the joint. But if the patellar mobility is free, but the still knee motion is restricted, then the fibrosis is in the quadriceps, which is extra articular fibrosis. Arthroscopically, ideally, patellar mobility should be restricted because it primarily addresses the intra-articular fibrosis. However, with advancements and with our work in this field, we have moved this procedure to remove intra-articular as well as extra-articular fibrosis. So we have expanded the indication and the scope to move from within the joint to outside the joint into the thigh muscles and release the scar tissue in that area. You will see it in one of the examples. Another criteria for selecting these cases is there should be no active infection. Needless to say, any infection will lead to refibrosis. The joint surfaces should be well maintained. We don't want to convert a painless stiff knee into a painful arthritic mobile knee. If the joint surfaces are very incongruent, it is better to do this procedure with a lot of caution and understanding. So ideally, joint surfaces should be reasonably well maintained. Needless to say, all fractures in that limb should have healed. The best way to find it out is patient should be able to put weight on the leg unsupported. If the fractures have not healed and one starts mobilizing the joint, the fracture may displace. So it is important to have all fractures in that limb to have healed before one takes up for an arthroscopic arthrofibrolysis. These are the instruments which are used for an arthroscopic arthrofibrolysis. This is a hook knife which was initially devised for lateral release, but it is very good for cutting the scar tissue in the suprapatellar area. In the suprapatellar area, one hooks this hook knife around a scar tissue, and just by pulling on the knife, the scar tissue is divided. It can be used in suprapatellar area because relatively there is no articular cartilage which it can damage or get stuck on. It should not be used in tibiofemoral area as there it can damage the articular cartilage. So it is useful for suprapatellar area and is a good instrument for rapid removal of tissue from that area. A common arthroscopy punch is very useful for removing the tissue in the intercondylar area, the gutters, where one cannot use the hook knife. This is a useful tissue. Once the tissue has been cut, it is removed from the joint using a suction power shaver. This removes the cut tissue from the joint and creates more space in the joint. Another very important component is the patience. One must have good amount of patience in a severely restricted motion in the knee, especially in the first part of the procedure where mobility and visualization is very much limited and it tests your patience. One of the examples in intra-articular fibrosis, post-synovectomy open, this knee became stiff. One could see the motion. After a little bit of release, this is the suprapatellar area. You can see the patella on the top, the femur below, and the fibrous tissue running like a bridge. A hook knife introduced from the superior lateral portal goes around the fibrous tissue in the suprapatellar pouch. And by pulling on the hook knife, one can rapidly divide the tissue. So one keeps dividing the tissue and keeps expanding the space in the suprapatellar area to get more space. One does not want to get into the space of the vastus medialis. As you can see on the right, the muscle is visible. One should not be violating this space. However, one can go from this space to lower thigh also. We'll see it in a subsequent case, not in this case, because here the fibrosis is only intra-articular. So once this tissue has been divided, a power shaver which sucks out and cuts the tissue is introduced to remove the divided tissue. So this was divided in this area with a hook knife, and the divided tissue is being removed. Some of the not too tough adhesions can itself be broken by the shaver also. It can also break some of the adhesions which are not very tough. As you are seeing, some of the adhesions per se, the shaver may be able to break. But tough adhesion, one definitely cannot cut with this. It needs to be cut with a hook knife or a punch. So there we are using a punch to cut some tough adhesions. And one keeps moving the scope all along the joint to see the fibrous tissue and cut it. Then one makes an intrapatellar portal and sees the tibiofibral joint. In this case, the surfaces are well maintained, but in fracture cases, it will not be so. Then the tissue is removed from the gutter area, and this was the range of motion one could get. You can see the shining skin in flexion, and in extension, it is not shining. This is an inelastic skin which shines in flexion, indicating that it would break down if a long cut was made. So this was the good range of motion which was achieved. Which are the cases which are suited . That means the joint was well maintained in mobility. Due to surgical scarring, the joint mobility has got restricted. Those cases are ideal. Post immobilization stiffness. Stiffness following immobilization due to fracture, due to trauma, due to any other reason. These are cases which are quite amenable to arthroscopic arthrofibrillation. Patellar fractures are a very common site for stiffness and have a good outcome with arthroscopic arthrofibrillation. Intra-articular tibial and femoral fractures. In tibial and femoral fractures, if the surfaces are well maintained, it are good cases. These are good cases. In femoral fracture, if they have been operated, there is adherent and fibrosed quadriceps, which also can be done arthroscopically. We will see it in one of the examples. Lower femoral fractures also. Knee which is stiff due to TKR can also benefit. We have removed cement pieces as well as dislocated patellar component in patients who had stiff knee. So these are also some of the cases which are suitable for arthroscopic arthrofibrillation. Another very particular example is a stiff knee with scarred skin. In a skin which is scarred, there are very few options of doing an open procedure. So this is one of the example, very extensive scarring. We don't want to see too many. These are very time consuming and demanding procedure. Another case, what you are seeing, the upper two pictures are from a young girl who came with a stiff knee, as you can see. And this was following a septic knee 15 years ago. She never took care of it for the last 15 years. And the skin was, the knee was so stiff, and the knee had such a bad septic that it needed to be skin grafted 15 years ago. So this was the pre-op picture, this picture as well as the one on the right. In this case, arthroscopically, we released the tissue through the three portals. One can see the portal right next here, a portal here, and a portal here. And this was the range of motion 15 years post septic stiff knee. So it is a very rewarding procedure in this case, and probably no other option to do an open procedure. another one of our very old patients, which we did almost about more in, I think, 94 or so. This taught us a lot of lessons about stiff knee, because at that time, stiff knee, even in books, was mentioned as a contraindication for arthroscopy. This patient had a fractured patella with skin grafting on the medial as well as the lateral side. So fracture had healed, and this was the range of motion we had pre-operative. So we were very skeptical if the scar tissue will break down once we release the tissue from the joint and the scar tissue is mobilized. So we were very skeptical what will happen. This was in the beginning of our experience. Once we released the tissue from within the joint, this was the movement at 15 days. This was the movement at 2 months. The scar tissue not only did not break down, to our surprise, the scar tissue stretched. And when the patient went into extension, the scar used to wrinkle in extension. So the periarticular tissues can stretch out secondary to release of intra-articular tissue. Once the intra-articular tissues have been released, the periarticular tissue, as in this case, scar on the thigh, can stretch out secondarily easily. So this was a lesson, and this scar used to wrinkle in extension. What are another cases I mentioned? Lower femoral fractures, intra-articular fractures. Here the scarring is not only intra-articular. This scarring is released by intra-articular release, as we saw just now. And once this area has been released, we move all up into the thigh using the arthroscope and going all the way. For releasing this scar tissue, a 3.5 millimeter periosteum elevator introduced through a portal in the thigh is a very good method to release the adherent musculature from the femur. In this procedure, we also see there is a bony ridge across which the quadricep is stretched. This bony ridge we did see when we were releasing the scar in the lower thigh. We will see it in the video, but we never touched this tissue as we did not want to create another raw surface. So we released the adherent quadriceps from this under arthroscopic vision and cut down, releasing all the way up. You will see it in the subsequent video. So what you are seeing is on the right is the intra-articular part of the procedure where the tissue is being released, and from the intra-articular part, one can release the tissue from the intra-articular part, and after you have done it, one introduces the periosteum intra-articularly, and one can visualize the bony ridge which we saw in the X-ray, and under vision release all the quadricep which is adherent to it. This is the outside picture where you are seeing the hook knife releasing the tissue. Then after the hook knife, the same shaver is introduced to remove the tissue. All this procedure is done first intra-articularly in different parts of the joint. And once the scope and the instrument can be moved freely inside the joint, it indicates that we have done an adequate release. One has to keep shifting the portal one through the other. From one side to other side, one has to keep interchanging the portal and releasing all the tissue. Once that has been done under vision, what we saw arthroscopically, this is a periosteum elevator which is releasing a tissue in the lower thigh. So we have released the tissue till here. Then what we do is we shift the scope to the higher portal, and then the space which has been created, we see it under the quadricep. We make a portal under visualization. In that space we have created using a periosteum, make a portal. This is a outside the joint. Again, use the same hook knife to release the fibrous bands in the suprapatellar pouch. Once they have been released, the same periosteum is used to elevate the tissue. then one puts the scope in the higher portal, and one can keep moving all the way up till where the plate is, or till wherever you find the normal tissue you have reached. Again, using the periosteum to release all the tissue in the lower third of the thigh from the front as well as the lateral side. So this is intra-articular as well as extra-articular release. This was the patient, the lower femoral fracture. This was the pre-operative extension. There was an extension lag. This was the flexion till about 35 degree or so pre-operatively. These are pre-operative picture. Post-operatively on the day one, without using any CPM, one can see that one is getting a comfortable range of motion the patient can get. Even this is day one, because next day the patient is being discharged, and that is what the patient has got, a comfortable range. Not complete, but it is keep on improving. Immediately in the post-op period, it is a good idea to keep the knee in a flexed position. In the post-op, it helps in hemostasis. So just after the surgery, when we have released the fibrous tissue, there is a lot of hemarthrosis. So in the post-operative period, we devise this skin, this sling with pillows, so that the knee is kept flexed passively also. This pushes the quadriceps on the femur and by pressure causes hemostasis. Even in the post-op period, the patient is encouraged to mobilize the knee by extending it. Now the same patient you saw for the femur, this was the pre-op flexion. This was the post-op flexion at 1 month, which you see on the right side. The left, we see the pre-op extension, which has extension lag. In the post-op period, as against an open procedure where there is an increased extension lag, we found that there is a gain in extension. Why should there be a gain in extension is what we found an interesting explanation. The explanation was that intrapatellar area, okay, once we remove it mechanically from this area, it helps in gaining extension. Another factor which we found could explain why we gain extension is the removal of wasted cordyceps pull. A knee which is fibrosed, like the one on the left, the quadriceps contracts, the force goes from quadriceps to the patella, and then from patella it goes to the femur. Because of fibrosis in that suprapatellar area, it does not go to the tibia. Once this fibrous tissue has been released, the pull of quadriceps goes from the femur to the patella to the tibia. So that is the reason that one gets a better extension in arthroscopically releasing this tissue. So we gain extension rather than lose extension, because the pull of the quadriceps, which was going from the patella to the femur, is now going to the tibia. So this is another advantage in an arthroscopic procedure. This is what we use, a CPM, an ordinary office chair. Since 2009, this is where the slide was made. We started using in 2009 this chair, which is available for everybody in the house. And this is how it is used. Patient sits and puts his stiff knee against the resistance and uses the power of arm and the opposite leg. So instead of electric motor, it is your muscles of the forearm, arm and the opposite leg which keeps moving the chair and does the work of a CPM. And this is the range of motion post-operatively at 6 months. What we could get, it has increased even further. We don't lose motion in most of these cases, because there is no added fibrosis of the procedure. Everybody cannot have a very good prognosis. Prognosis is good if it is a post-surgical fibrosis, which means that the joint was all right before the surgery and the surgery led to fibrosis. Those cases are very good for an arthroscopic fibrolysis. The joint surfaces should be well preserved to help a painful, pain-free motion as well as a free motion. Fibrosis should be intra-articular as against intra and extra-articular. prognosis is moderate if there is intra and periarticular fibrosis. The joint coagulability is reasonable and the infection has healed in the knee. In these cases, one gets a moderate outcome of the results. Prognosis is bad if there is scarring of the entire cordyceps, especially with Elizarov, external fixation, or osteomyelitis. There, after releasing the intra-articular tissue, a limited lateral incision, intermedius release through a small incision can be added. This is not a very common occurrence, but if it is so, intermediate release, not through a cordycepsplasty, but it is called a mini cordycepsplasty, one can still get a good range of motion when the intra-articular tissue and the combined has been released from intermediate release. Thank you very much.